Disclaimer. This is going to be a more personal video. Anime analysis will at best only happen tangentially. And as for the term moe, I'm going to use it flippantly as both an affectionate reaction to a cute character as well as synonymous with the cute girls doing cute things genre and archetypes therein that also appear all over other otaku media. The story of me getting into anime is one deeply tied to the story of who I am, what I had to come to terms with, and what made me who I am now. And all of this had its most recent climax in an event that the Discord community I'm active in called my Moe Redemption Arc. What brought this about, and what even made it necessary in the first place, is a story about me breaking walls that I had erected around myself and around my identity. Intrigued? If yes, then please be welcome to listen to the story that I will share now. But do note that this is a story about me, but it's also a story that I think many people will be able to relate to, since we all construct identities for ourselves and interact through them with others, and there's probably only a few people who could say that they have always been honest with themselves about who they are, or even more likely, they didn't even find out who they are yet. This is also a story of self-betterment and self-confidence found in one of the most unlikely places. My first experience with anime was the stuff you'd expect, TV anime, DBZ, One Piece, Yu-Gi-Oh! And the likes. As a kid I liked them a lot, and they were just about my favorite thing in the world. I'd arrange my limited TV watching time around the time these shows aired, and I always demanded that my mother tape these episodes that I'd otherwise miss, so I can confidently say that it was a big part of my identity as a kid. DBZ was my generation's shit. It was all we were talking about in elementary school. Though this love stopped. The last anime I watched before I stopped was already pretty deep level stuff, to be honest. It may not seem like that nowadays, but what I watched was the 2003 Fullmetal Alchemist anime with English fan subs. Me, a German boy of 12 years, with a base level education in English since 5th grade. Yeah, that was way more out there than anyone at that time in 2006 that I knew. So, what changed? It almost feels like a trope at this point to say bullying happened, but that's what it was. I was a sensitive, picky and meek kid in elementary school. I had a crush on a girl that was really manipulative about that. While she consciously kept me close to gain favors from me, she usually just went with the more fashionable or cool boys. Those cool boys with their expensive clothes and the rap music about sex and crime. Well, I don't want to dive too deep into this passage, but what this thought planted to my mind was, you need a facade that is stronger, cooler, and better than them in every way to get social reward. My daydreams at that time were filled with power fantasies. I was constantly fantasizing about a stronger me that would impress people, make them respect me, and get me with the girls. Pretty pathetic looking back on it. Well, this idea in the back of my head exploded all over me when I left elementary school and went on to middle school. I wasn't ready for what happened there. Because I looked sort of girlish and had long hair and decided to be a good student for my middle school time, and I was just generally more preoccupied with being nice to everyone than to be nasty and offensive. And that's why I was bullied. Looking back, I can confidently say that I did have an especially nasty class. 7th graders who were defining their social status on a basis of racist slurs, violence, vandalism, and general rudeness and breaking of all rules. 12-year-olds openly smoking in the school lot and insulting the teachers who dare tell them otherwise. Lovely environment. I don't want to deep dive into the details, but what I want to highlight is my reaction to it. I never really searched for the problem in myself. I knew the people around me were just horrible to each other and to me, and that they also treated me unfairly. I needed to find out how to prevent this, and the lesson I had previously learned came back to my mind. You must be stronger, cooler, harder than the rest. This and my suppressed anger that I had no outlet for led me to music. Metal music specifically. Hard, deep, masculine, intense, aggressive. Angry outsider's music and spirit with an air of intellectual superiority because of the politically and socially conscious lyrics, but also almost forbidden knowledge, an interest no one else had around me. Something rad as fuck. I had to shed the child I was before that. I had to get rid of what defined me previously. It wasn't good enough. My peers weren't talking about DBZ anymore. They were being edgy and listening to Mina's music to show how tough they were. I need to man up and surpass them in every way. Anime is out, metal is in. The straw that broke the camel's back was seeing Naruto on TV though. It stood for all the things I had now internalized to refuse. Quirky, goofy, colorful, optimistic, That wasn't something I could like, if I'm going to be strong at least. I looked right past the good messages that would have legitimately helped me at that time and built my wall. Black clothes, harder and harder music, countless hours of lonely free time that sent me deeper into the metal sphere, and their communities pulled me further away from anime and other kiddie stuff like it. Online, I was surrounded by people defined by masculinity and strength. Anime was at best only mentioned in negative remarks made by them. Well, to cut this a little short, the facade worked to some degree. The bullying got less, my behavior was reinforced. It was accepted as a thing I do, and that made me at least somewhat unique and less meek. Over years of erecting that wall and making it stronger and stronger, I added a sort of intellectual arrogance to it, because I quickly noticed that my peers couldn't challenge me in that regard. I talked about progressive metal and how complex and superior it is. I talked about deep lyrics. I read old books and thought I was an aesthetic genius for having such refined taste. Let's fast forward a bit. When I changed to high school, my life was flipped upside down. Suddenly, I was sitting in a classroom with four other metalheads who were all really relaxed, had social recognition, and we all shared a common interest. Q, my own K-On. We immediately clicked. Formed the school band, got access to the practice room, and out there almost every other day, making music, drinking beer, playing cards. It was fucking fantastic. A group of people like me, accepting of me. People with the same edgy facade of strength and masculinity, metal. But nothing of that friendship was actually superficial or shallow in any way. These were really good people who are really good for my psyche. I learned to fully utilize my wall as leverage for social and sexual success, and quickly gained confidence and independence thanks to it. I had reached a point of actual happiness thanks to my wall. Of course, this isn't advocating for constructing walls. This is a story of how that wall got torn down and I found myself. Fast forward a bit, and I start going to college. I develop further and further away from metal music and realize I can project intellectual superiority much better if I dive into more obscure and more experimental music genres. And I actually found lots of music I liked and still liked there. This is truly the irony of my musical ventures. I created a wall and identity for the protection of myself and out of ignorance for my true desires, yet still in the process opening and broadening my horizons forever and finding desires I never knew I had. Being in college, being relatively well read, being in constant contact with cultural criticism and old literature, and being into headier music really elevated my sense of self at the time. I brushed the facade of strength and edginess aside and replaced it fully with one of intellectualism, which was still not without ideas about masculine strength that I wanted to see in myself. But slowly even those crumbled, since I was happy, successful, romantically, socially. I was recognized by my family and my peers. And what I was observing at that time was that most of my important friends all watched anime. We often talked about that and I was recommended things that I easily dismissed. I thought back to my experience with the show I saw as a kid and I was completely stereotyping all of the anime and saying that I don't care about little boys screaming and fighting. I had already internalized that it's kid stuff and has no intellectual value. I still couldn't reconcile it with my sense of self. But one fateful day, when I saw it on discount in the PSN store, I played the game Persona 3. Because I knew I liked JRPGs enough to maybe get past the anime bullshit in it. But I got totally sucked into it. I played it, and then played Persona 4. And I cried my eyes out at the end and was completely blown away by it. Seems of creating a persona to oppress your inner self, your shadow, that you won't allow yourself to accept were hitting incredibly close to home. And I got attached to the friendship as depicted in the game. So open, so accepting, so nice on every level, innocent, no posturing. I had great friends in high school and I still have them. But posturing really was part of that friendship. We were all hardcore metalheads after all. Being rude, rebellious and rotten was part of that identity. Cynical, sarcastic, intellectual, pricks. And it was good. And I still am all of those things. But Persona 4 showed me something of the other side. The warm, friendly, innocent friendship. The open friendship. Of accepting yourself fully. And damn did it affect me emotionally. It changed me. Now came the time I listened to myself and tried to make sense of what I was hearing. My interest in anime rose and I talked about it with my friends a lot. Talked to them about Persona. I even watched the different Persona anime. And I liked them well enough. Yeah, Persona 4 the animation was my first anime after Full Metal Alchemist in 2006. I listened and my girlfriend approached me and said, I found this nice anime, wanna maybe watch it together? And I did. And we binged the show that day. It was The Devil is a Part-Timer. Yeah, not really the greatest achievement of mankind or anything, but it was nice and funny to me back then. No idea if it still holds up in any way, but by the end, I had reacted to something in that show. I was sitting there, not really being able to express what I just felt, except I want to like cute things too. This may sound like a huge breakthrough, but it really was only a first little brick that I removed from the wall, because me getting into anime was still an issue. With me saying that I want to like cute things too, I shared my wrong ideas about being hard and masculine completely. I listened to what I wanted and did that, but the next hill to overcome was my pretentious intellectualism. I was very aware of how shitty the writing in the couple of anime was that I saw thereafter, and for months I was really just slowly going through shows, trying to find ones I really liked. The show that finally convinced me was Gurren Lagann, my first 10 out of 10 and only 11 out of 10 to this day. It spoke to me with its elaborate themes of pushing past your own limits, with its way of talking about masculinity, with its relentless message of self-empowerment and rejection of authority and oppression. Gurren Lagann single-handedly blasted a huge chunk of my wall away. That made me really start watching anime, starting with the winter 2017 season. And you know what? I even liked the cute girl show of that time. Kobayashi-san's Dragon Maid, for example. The first KyoAni show I watched. At that time, I was still inexperienced. That's why it was so easy for me to simply like it and not think ill of it. But once I dove deeper into otaku media and experienced the lowest point yet, something insidious crept into my conception of anime. Sword Art Online happened. And I remember vividly how it gradually alienated me, and it made me realize the treatment of women in this is horrible. They're tropes, pandering cliches, fetishized admirers of the self-insert main character. This left scars. Suddenly, this thought was always there. What if this cuteness is insidious otaku wish fulfillment? What if this is written by creepy lonely people who fantasize shit about being a powerful, desirable man like I did back in elementary school? It was eerily similar, but I had moved far, far past that. One of the most positive aspects of my experiences with metalhead culture was, as I mentioned, social success and sexual success, one based on mutualness, openness. I had experience with women who were individuals, strong-willed and unique just as I was. Not the kind of pathetic fantasies that someone without success concocts in their mind to make themselves feel empowered. And anime was clearly presenting me with aggressive ideas here. It was patronizing me. It was pandering in a way that was disgusting to me because it reminded me of my own past weakness. And at this point in my life, I was already way past weakness. I was all about self-empowerment. What happened is that my wall was completely torn down on one side, but on the other side, I was reinforcing it against Moe, which I viewed as symptomatic of the broader issue of weakness and pandering and disempowerment, and also as the biggest intellectual issue with anime in terms of overuse of tropes and generic character archetypes. This way of thinking was in some ways reinforced by the videos of Digibro, who I've been watching at that time. But, and here comes the big conflict and the protagonist of my Moe Redemption arc. Digibro loves K-On! At the time he called it his favorite show of all time. How could the man, who could in so much detail explain why the Asterisk War sucks, is generic and treats his characters like tropes, like a genre that is so deeply associated with just that problem? Yeah, of course, I watched his videos on it, and I was convinced to try the show out, but I didn't do so until early 2018. At that point I had watched a good amount of anime, and was pretty well versed in the history of the medium and the classics, and had also already dropped a good chunk of Moe shows, bad seasonal shows that are not noteworthy by any means. Sometimes between deciding to watch K-On! And starting it, I also watched Welcome to the NHK, a show that deeply confirmed my view of otaku in relation to pandering. It delivers a fantastic parody of the mind-numbing self-indulgence that can happen with otaku. When Yamazaki blasts a vapid, meaningless, bubbly Purin Purin song all day and drives Sato mad. And later when Sato enters the otaku culture himself and you see all the ways in which he is pathetic and weak. And then I spotted a wild otaku in Berlin. I was sitting next to him on a train. A fat, unkempt man wearing a waifu t-shirt with all the K-On! Blu-rays in a shopping bag next to him. Seems he had just bought them. And I know how expensive those things are. Suddenly, these two things were linked in my mind. That man next to me looked like what I had seen in NHK. And of course it's shit of me to just assume something like that of a total stranger, but my mind worked that way in that moment in time. Some time passed and then I watched K-On! For the first time. I had a free afternoon and just decided to watch all of season 1 in one sitting. And these were my thoughts, word for word, after finishing it.
I hate Japan. Moe girls are always nearly retarded. K-On! Kind of has this problem. Kind of. I've seen worse. I really get the Sora Yori vibe from K-On! Like, guys, you're supposed to have a goal and ambition, why the fuck do you just fap around all day? And K-On! Is even worse. Like, every single practice is like, okay, let's eat cake. I recently watched Bakuman, and that had many arcs where the mangaka literally did not sleep because they were working non-stop on their dream. K-On! Seems kinda lazy in comparison. For example, Antarctica was a travel story drama, and Dragon Maid is more or less a slice of life but comedy. Pure Moe is when the show isn't especially about comedy and not especially about drama or story, but mostly about looking at cute girls doing cute things, like K-On! That they're on a band doesn't matter since they don't do shit. They just do cute stuff. And the thing is, Moe tropes don't hook me. I see them as, oh, that's the anime bullshit again. If I like a Moe show, like Dragon Maids or Konosuba or others, it's because things around the Moe make the show good.
Does this hurt yet? It sure kinda hurts me. My final verdict was a 6 out of 10, so it's not like I hated it, but I still wasn't too impressed with it either. Fast forward a couple of months and I joined the Digibro Patreon Discord later that year. And of course my opinions about K-On! Quickly got me into conflict with some of the members there. Well, let's not say conflict. Let's say friendly discussions. We're debating everything about Moe, cute girls and other shows with that kind of appeal, and I felt the urge to do the thing that has proven right in the past as well. Broaden my horizon. Open myself up again. Allow myself to like something. I said, alright, convince me. Give me shows to watch that will make me get it, and I'll work through them before I restart K-On! So I did. I started and dropped multiple shows of that kind in the time frame. I even finished Lucky Star, and I liked it. Mostly for the comedy, but still. I had not gained much more experience with the genre, and I still was negative and unimpressed. If you asked me at that time, I would have said that the way the guys in the Discord talked about the show could feel fetishistic to me, because they were repeatedly talking about cuteness. That felt patronizing to me, fetishistic. My default mode of thinking is that Moe is indulgent stuff for people who fetishize weak women. But at some point after starting the first handful of episodes of K-On! Again, I watched a video by Pedantic Romantic and then one by Under the Scope, where both of them talked about Naoko Yamada as a director and her style and importance. And suddenly it dawned on me, wait, Yamada is a woman. Kiyo Ani, who made K-On!, had a large percentage of female staff. A large percentage of the audience of K-On! Is female. There must be something more than pandering to this. And since I had previously been exposed to worse cute girl shows, I gave K-On! A really fair shot, and my wall, or as I called it then, a T-field, was shattered. It clicked with me. I might hate some otaku versions of Moe, but this ain't that, I realized. K-On! Is a very honest celebration of femininity, growing up, and friendship. I don't want to deep dive into the specifics here, but suddenly everything made sense. I could relate their friendship to my own experiences with my friends in high school. I suddenly realized that their lack of ambition in terms of music that I previously harshly criticized was a way of life, an expression of their friendship. The way to make me get it was to make me see for myself that this ain't that. I initially went in pretty biased, quickly saw some surface level tropes evolving, got pissed off, and turned very cynical. Like, being mad because the characters were acting like slackers and ditzes. And it was what I thought was some sort of Moe bullshit that tried to propagate weak women. And that is what is called not getting it. Specifically considering the origin of Moe, K-On! Is a show that really reclaims the ground for an unbridled expression of femininity. It takes out the male gaze component, gives a show to a very female staff to animate in a male-dominated industry no less, and creates a show that depicts female characters on their own terms that aren't defined by their relationship to men. Which of course to this degree isn't realistic. Because in reality, of course you relate to the people around you, regardless of gender. But that is what makes K-On! Feel decidedly unique. It's a deliberate depiction of girls on their own terms, which serves to highlight the underrepresented parts of femininity that get lost between the beautiful fighting girl archetypes, the damsels, the love interests, and the token female characters that many other casts only get. A lot of Moe characters at least annoy me as soon as you put them into relationship with male characters and they become submissive to them. This usually highlights an incredible gender power imbalance in the work that makes me uncomfortable, and those moe traits are usually depicted to appeal to a male gaze. But Kaon is a rare case study, where a manga that was originally exactly that got picked up by a motivated team of dominantly women who decided to alter the text to turn the moe caricatures of the original Falcoma into real people that we can relate to on the basis of their realness. All of this arc happened live for everyone to see in that Discord server, and the Kaon fans there were happy to let me join the ranks of people who have loved Kaon. This is where I'm at. I'm not sure my wall is torn down. I'm self-aware about that. At the moment, I'm mostly restricted to loving the great moe shows by Naoko Yamada and occasional others, but I'm still bothered and very aware of the more pandering and mindless moe that I see everywhere. My emotional arc of being allowed to enjoy cute things was concluded by an example of cuteness that couldn't be destroyed or be broken by doubt, intellectual scrutiny or cynicism. Something that warmed my heart so much and worked on every layer for me.